Okay, so to prove that we have a model for GDP and stuff is done over time, or let's say propensity X, and the times the relationship looks like this. And suppose that we are living, let's say, in 1990. Right here. We want to forecast GDP in 1995. So we are using data for the 80s. Here's 1980. 10 years of data. And at this point, that the trend is very strong and positive in GDP. So it would be very natural to predict a path that looks like this. Now it's 2000 and we look back at our forecast. And we say, good heavens, our forecast is entirely incorrect. GDP has fallen rather than risen in this case. Part of the problem here is that we have a non-stationary time series. So, what does non-stationarity mean in this case? If you recall from econometrics, this is a time series that changes in very basic ways over time. This is unfortunate for all LS because in econometrics, usually we have only past data to use. So we often assume that whatever has happened in the past will continue to happen in the future. For a non-stationary time series, however, that is not correct. The series is changing, and we have to find a way of anticipating that change to have an accurate forecast. Okay. Now here is another puzzle for you. A different time series. this time GDP for country Y. And here is the prime trend for GDP. Do you think that this series will cause us problems in forecasting? For example, if we are forecasting back here in the year 2000. What do you think now? Well, of course, the forecast should be very accurate this time because there is no change in the overall trend of GDP before and after 2000. Now, this is curious because one of the conditions for stationarity is that we have a mean for the time series that does not change. But usually, stationarity means that the mean, the arithmetic average of the data is constant over time and also variance is constant as well. So you remember that variance is a measure of dispersion. And a slightly technical point, we'll get to this later on. The true variance over a given time period also is constant. We'll explain that later. In this case, the mean is higher after 2000 than before 2000. So technically, this is not a stationary time series. But we don't worry about that because you can see that there is a strong linear relationship between time and GDP. So all that we have to do is to model GDP with a time trend. And then anything else that you want to include. Plus the random variable of the measures, the error in the forecast. So after we control for the time trend, GDP is stationary. In particular, controlling for time, GDP is a constant with a random variable. If we're controlling for any other independent variables. So in this case, controlling for time and ignoring the other independent variables that we might add suggests a series that looks like this. at the WA. So there's one very easy way that you can adjust for something that is changing over time. Just introduce a time trend and see if that will solve the problem. Now, here's a puzzle for you. Of two series over time. Let's say this time for investment. Here's one series. Maybe reflecting an inventory cycle. So we'll call that time series A. And here's another time series. Steady investment, I will call this D. Question, is A more or less stationary than B? What do you think? Remembering that stationarity means that we have a constant mean and a constant variance as well. Though, surprisingly enough, by this definition, A is actually closer to being stationary than B. Even though A is volatile, the volatility, the variance does not change. In other words, stationarity does not mean that we have zero variance. A series can be volatile and also stationary. B, on the other hand, has a linear time trend. So technically, it is not stationary because the mean is changing over time. But then, if we consult for the time trend, then will be stationary. So this is just by way of introduction to analyzing stationarity. And there is the reason why we worry about non-stationarity. Most time series in economics, but GDP or population, or a death bench does or fall over time. So there's always the possibility that if we dress one time series on another in economics, people find a relationship that looks non-dual, but in fact is nonsense. Instead, the two time theories look as if they relate to one another because they really are relating to a time trend. And so, rather than take a guess at whether a relationship is serious or not, we will adjust time series for time trend and then take a look at what remains. So there is one condition of stationarity. Again, the mean does not depend on time. The variance also is independent of time. And you remember that the variance is the expected value of the gap between y at time t and the mean for the whole series squared. A measure of dispersion devoted to this gap, devoted to the variance, is going to be. And then here is the third condition, which maybe is not as important as the other two, but nevertheless is necessary to defining stationarity. You remember that covariance is measuring whether or not two random variables tend to rise or fall over time. Or to move in opposite directions. So, for example, we just saw that money and prices tend to rise together over time. When money increases, prices increase as well. So if we're looking at the expected value of this product, money at time t minus its mean, I'll just call it m. Times the deviation of prices at time t relative to its own mean. This expected value should be positive. When money grows quickly, prices grow quickly as well. This is a positive covariance. And then what about this example? GDP of per capita and death rates. So let's denote that GDP, real GDP, is Y minus its mean times the deviation of death rates. What do you think now? Is this expectation likely to be positive or negative? So, of course, we observe that richer countries usually have lower death rates than poorer countries. So, if you're taking data across countries for why, will GDP and perceived death rates be observed a negative relationship this time? This covariance is negative. Okay, and one last example of Vandenberg Belt of the price of cheese in China. And the level of population in Colombia. What do you think now of that covariance? Is it positive as an expectation, negative, or something else? Well, of course, there is no reason to think that there is any relationship between the price of cheese in China and the local population in Colombia. No evident relationship here. So there's the price of cheese. Here's the population. And there is no reason to think that when cheese prices rise, population will either rise or fall systematically. Instead, these two variables are utterly independent of one another. If cheese prices rise, sometimes population will rise also, and sometimes it will fall. Without a systematic relationship, it is not the case that this product is either positive or negative all the time. Sometimes it's positive and sometimes it's negative. So the covariance turns to zero. For independent random variables. Okay, are you comfortable with the intuition behind covariance? Okay, good. for extra credit, this just for one more example. For income and level of education. What do you think? Is this computer's recipe positive or negative or zero? Think of some say. What did you guess? Though, of course, surely this relationship is positive. Richer households may purchase more education at a given time. So that at least is our expectation. Or is it? So let's take an individual. Today works when they can find a good job, and many can't. People step to school. To improve his analytical skills. So for Sergei, income and education at a given time has perhaps a negative relationship. When the economy goes into a recession, his income falls, and then he goes back to school so that he is not wasting his time. For today, the covariance of income and education is actually negative. Surprisingly enough, the covariance across countries to income and education at a given time is negative because of the substitution effect. Okay, so I have 16 minutes after 8 now. Would you like to take a 15-minute break and then we will reconvene at about 8:30? Questions? Answers? Okay. I will see you in 15 minutes. Thank you.